It's Friday, so it's 12 minutes past 11 o'clock, and I'm delighted to say we have another confession. And into the confessional booth, for the first time ever, Darren Reddick is going to be here. I don't know whether you're a forgiving type, Darren, whether you kind of hear a story, it's fine, or whether you're actually quite judgmental. What would you say?
Probably judgmental.
Really? I was surprised. I thought you'd be a very kind of...
Well, it depends. I mean, you know, there's the outward opinion, and then there's the inward. Which would you prefer? The inward one is more judgy.
I would like the judgy one, I think.
Okay, then
I like the judgy one. Hey, tell us, when's your Darcy Bustle interview going out?
That's on Point Sunday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, with another chance to hear it on Tuesday at 7 o'clock in the evening.
All right. Yes. And what do you talk about with Darcy?
Dancing.
Really? Not sandwich fillings?
No, but, you know, I asked her some... I like to ask stupid questions too. I asked her for what I think is generally understood what a Spinal Tap moment is. Mm-hmm. I think that's sort of transferred across the galaxy and beyond the worlds of rock. And so she did tell me a few things that have gone wrong, which are always funny. I always find those things funny, to pull back the curtain with mm-hmm. my ballet dancer friends, because funny stuff happens.
So that's On Point, which is on Sunday at 1 o'clock with Darcy Bustle.
Yes.
All right, very good. Thank you. You can stay and hang around. You're not just here to plug your
chair. Yeah.
Jodie B is here.
Don't say that. Jodie Bryant. Or Jodie.
Ooh,
we've spoken about this. Oh, sorry. He calls me Jodie B, and we discussed...
Anyway, and Rick Radio is here. Radio Rick, as he's known sometimes.
Yeah, basking in the glow of the Arsenal victory last night.
3-1, away goal. Is that's the Thursday Night Cup, isn't it?
Yes, the one that matters.
Sorry. Darren's glazed over.
Are there touchdowns in this game?
Yes.
Who scored the most of those?
Here's today's tale. It comes from Tamsin. Thank you, Tamsin, for today's confession. Father Simon and the judging jury. This confession happened a long time ago, but is still so present and scarring in my mind that I need to get it off my chest. About 13 years ago, I was, of course, a lot younger than I am now, and it had just hit the summer holidays. School was out. 6 glorious weeks free of the dreaded physics teacher and skirts that were too long. Whoopee. Being the multitasker that I am, my summer was planned to be jam-packed with parties, camping trips, and although I wanted 100% party time, my parents did not let me forget to sort out some work experience. I knew that the career I had decided to follow involved years of grueling work experience, making teas and many unpaid internships, so I knew they were right. I was set. The summer began. I had a nice internship organised for 2 weeks, parties and holidays on either side of my hard work. But you see, Father Simon, this is a period of life that I'm sure everyone goes through, and the partying does not stop. We'd discovered drinks that make you happy.
Right.
We hadn't discovered hangovers, we just discovered cider and beer and wine and things like that. Okay?
Good old days.
I ended up going out most nights before going into my internship the next day, which was fine. I was young and I could handle that sort of thing, which I can't anymore. So one night, my best friend, let's call her Georgia, was having a gathering at her house, and no one else had summer work experience the next day apart from me. I thought I couldn't miss the party, so I went along. I thought, I'll be up at 6:30, I'll grab a latte and a croissant on the way in, and I'll be fine. Though, to be honest, I wish I hadn't gone. The party was great, although it meant sleeping over and then leaving Georgia's house at around 7 a.m. the next morning after probably a 3-hour sleep. I don't know how I kept this mentality going for so long, but I leapt up at 6:30, ready for the work and the day ahead. I got ready. I stealthily crept around Georgia and my other sleeping friends, Holly and Annabelle, and I tiptoed down the stairs. I made it to the front door, and then I realised, bother, I've forgotten my headphones. A commute without headphones is painful. In fact, a commute without headphones is impossible, let alone a lingering hangover commute without headphones. So I tiptoed back up the stairs to collect them from Georgia's room. I made it halfway up the stairs. And let me paint a picture for you. Georgia's room is on the top floor. Her parents' room is directly below it, facing the stairs, going down to the ground floor. I was coming up the stairs to collect my headphones. As I reached about the third stair of the ground to middle floor, I heard a creak and I looked up. George's dad had opened his bedroom door, carrying an iPad in one hand and an iPhone in the other, obviously going to the bathroom, which was on his right and my left. And he had no clothes on.
Oh, no.
This was a shocking sight, and I didn't know where to look. I stuck my hands in front of my eyes, and I said, it was 7 a.m., Trevor! I had a slightly strangled voice. It didn't really sound like me. Just before my cry, Trevor quickly used the iPhone to cover his front and the iPad to cover the back, and then he switched them round. Anyway, I gasped audibly in horror, and he yelled back, sounding very scared, "Who's that?" I then realised he wasn't wearing his glasses, and he didn't know who I was. So I say, Barbara. I couldn't bear standing in the stairwell with my best friend's dad without him wearing any clothes. Anyway, it was 5 seconds too long, so I ran down the stairs to the train station. It was a blur. He did not know that it was me. He might have thought they were being burgled. He might have thought it was a nightmare. I had a headphone-less journey to work, and when Georgia found my headphones, I wasn't able to claim them, or it might blow my cover. I never told Georgia. I never told her mum, and I never told her dad. It wasn't awkward the next time I saw him, so he couldn't have known it was me. I don't know if he told them what he'd heard or who he thought Barbara was, but it was never spoken of again. Father Simon says, Tamsin, I need to get this off my chest. It was humiliating for me and humiliating for him. He's probably been living with the fear of a teen like this for a while. It was me. I didn't mean it. Trevor, I hope you're listening, and I'm very, very sorry. It wasn't Barbara and it wasn't a burglar. I hope you can forgive me. I mean, there's a moral in this, which is... don't have sleepovers. Don't have a party and allow people to stay over. That's what I'm saying. That's Tams's confession. And the judging look that I'm getting from Darren here is going to be quite revealing. What do you say, Darren?
Well,
guilty, first of all, forgiven, not forgiven?
Oh, she is. I think the blame falls firmly on Trevor here. Now, I have kids.
Yes.
They have sleepovers.
Yes.
And I often have a threat of behave yourself where I will walk around the house naked. You see what I'm saying? Trevor certainly was aware that there was a sleepover and a party going on in his house.
Yes.
Was he not?
It was Trevor's fault.
I think he was remiss in clothing himself. So I think our protagonist here is gets off scot-free, so okay. to speak.
So Trevor is not forgiven, but Tamsin definitely is.
Yes.
As far as you're concerned.
Yeah.
Jodie B.
I think the opposite. I think Tamsin, she's left at 13 years, remember? And Trevor probably thinks back to this moment with horror, feeling a bit sick whenever he thinks about it. He's probably thinking, who was that person who saw me naked all those years ago? Am I allowed to say naked? Sorry. No clothes, with no clothes
on.
And yeah, so he's probably scarred by this experience and you've left it far too long, in my opinion.
Okay, so it's finally balanced. It's one all. The deciding vote.
Absolutely forgiven. She was having to deal with nudity, dealing with a hangover, dealing with the scramble for headphones. She made a good situation. It's a bad situation, really good. And also, that's not the kind of service you get in the Apple store, is it?
No, that's true. What, you know, everyone insists on wearing clothes.
Yeah, not the ones I go to.
Yeah. Okay, so it's if you want to have your say, if you're the people's verdict on this, you can text us 64100. The first word is Scala. Thank you, and thank you very much, judging panel. That was most illuminating.